Meanwhile, the required amount of explosives is procured at distant storage centers. Only enough explosives for a particular blast are delivered to safety zones at any one time, and only one box is carried at a time to the drill holes. As a precaution against failure, two primers are used at each hole. A unique spring-operated lowering device gently deposits the charge at the bottom of the hole and rewinds in preparation for another load. About 1,000 pounds of explosive may be used in each hole. A special truck fills the remaining space with stemming. This consists of finely crushed rock and serves as a plug. An explosive detonating cord is strung and connected to each hole. It is not a wire, but an explosive cord which carries a detonating wave to all holes at the rate of 23,000 feet per second. Everyone in the blasting area is then warned. The area is rapidly cleared of all men. The blasting cap is then attached to the end of the detonating cord, and the preparations for the blast are complete. Powerful electric shovels are then moved in to scoop up the broken rock. Water is sprayed around the working area to lay the dust. Areas being shoveled are identified as either ore or waste by targets set up as a result of studies of the churn drill samplings. The train crews are advised by markers on the shovel as to whether the material being loaded is ore or waste. The train loads of ore are transported to the concentrator. The operation of such open pit mines requires the construction and maintenance of extensive railroad systems and roads within the pit. Locomotives are electric powered with diesel auxiliaries, so that they may be operated by main line electrical power or independently. With the loading areas on the various levels constantly receding, the shifting of miles of heavy standard gauge track is a continuous activity. Communication by both telephone and shortwave radio systems keeps supervisory personnel in close contact with detailed mine operations, while a dispatching center controls the heavy traffic on the numerous levels, as well as to and from the concentrator and waste dumps. The waste loads are deposited at waste dumps, which over the years develop into mountainous proportions. As these vast dumps build up, the railroad tracks must constantly be shifted to the outer edges. This is accomplished quickly and efficiently with a track-moving machine. Such modern innovations now enable the industry to work even relatively low-grade ore areas with efficiency and economy. From the pit, the trains bearing ore move to the crushing plant of the concentrator. In addition to mining, there are three major steps in the production of copper from low-grade ores: concentrating, smelting, and refining. In the concentration process, the ore is crushed and ground so that the copper-bearing minerals may be literally floated clear of the waste materials. The water from flotation is removed by filters. It is not economically feasible to smelt the ore directly, since the ore may contain about 1 pound of copper to 99 pounds of waste. The concentration process removes about 96 pounds of these waste materials. is first fed into a gigantic crusher. This gyratory crusher can crush as much as 1,200 tons of ore an hour and easily breaks boulders weighing several tons. Crushed ore is then transported to storage bins, from which it is withdrawn and subjected to two additional crushing treatments. Screens are used in conjunction with these latter crushers to remove finished material and pass unfinished material back to the crushers. All of the ore is thus crushed down to pieces of a size considered suitable for the next step of the process, fine grinding in ball mills. In the ball mills, the ore, having been mixed with water, is finely ground by the tumbling and rolling of steel balls. This releases the copper minerals from the associated waste rock. During the milling, chemicals are added which will assist in flotation. The product issuing from the ball mills flows to classifiers, where a separation of the material of finished size is accomplished. The unfinished size material is returned to the ball mill by the screw action of the classifier spiral. The finished material overflows the classifier tank and passes to the flotation machines at a lower level. In these flotation tanks, called cells, we see what is actually the first stage of separation of copper minerals from the finely ground and prepared copper ore. In the cells, the mixture of ground ore, water, and flotation chemicals is subjected to agitation by the injection of air. This forms a mass of bubbly froth in the tanks. The particles of copper iron sulfide, which is the chemical form in which copper appears in this particular ore, have been made water repellent by the chemicals added during grinding, and therefore have an affinity for the air bubbles of the froth. The froth collects them and carries them to the surface of the cells, leaving most of the waste material behind. The frothy bubbles, now carrying a high percentage of copper iron sulfide, gently slide over the edges of the cells. This rough concentrate still contains some waste. It is routed to an additional classifying and grinding treatment, then to flotation for maximum elimination of remaining waste particles. The final concentrate is sent to thickening tanks where the bubbles are broken down and the copper-bearing minerals settle to the bottom and are removed. The water is drawn from the top for reuse. The metal-laden concentrate is then sent to vacuum filters which draw off most of the remaining water. Suction draws the concentrate to the porous surface of the filters where moisture is drawn out as the drum rotates. At a release point, air pressure is applied and the thickened concentrate is removed from the drum. The final concentrate, now containing about 30% copper, is ready for smelting. Meanwhile, back in the flotation cells, the waste materials called tailings flow to settling tanks or thickeners. Water is recovered from the top for reuse, and the thickened tailings are drawn to the center by rakes and removed. From the thickeners, the tailings are conveyed by large pipes to vast tailing dams, where the solid matter settles and the remaining water is recovered for use at the concentrator. Of every 100 tons of ore treated, 96 tons end up as waste deposited at these dams. In the smelting operation, the concentrated ore is subjected to heat and chemical processes, resulting in the extraction of metallic copper. The molten metal from a reverberatory furnace, which removes some of the impurities as slag, is further refined in a converter furnace. After subsequent treatment in an anode furnace, the almost pure copper is poured into the molds of a casting wheel. At the smelter, these operations succeed in extracting metallic copper of about 99.5% purity. In this building, known as a bedding plant, flux is distributed over huge piles of concentrate. Flux aids the fusion of the non-sulfide portion of the material into slag during furnace treatment. A special rake draws off and combines the desired mixture of flux and concentrate. The mixed charge is introduced through the top of a reverberatory furnace. The intense heat created within these gas-fired furnaces is periodically checked with instruments, including the optical pyrometer, which measures temperature by the brilliance of the furnace interior. The lighter waste material, known as slag, rises to the top of the molten mass. From time to time, this material is drawn off and discarded. Meanwhile, in the furnace, a molten mass containing copper, sulfur, and iron has been accumulating. This material is known as mat. When sufficient time has elapsed, the mat is drawn off. It is then carried to another furnace, known as a converter. In the converter, the iron and sulfur content of the mat is removed by additional processes. One important step is the forcing of compressed air through the molten mass. Men protected by hoods from flying bits of hot metal keep the air ducts open by frequent punching. Helps to burn off the sulfur and change the iron to slag. The slag, which is formed in the converter, contains some copper. It is therefore collected and returned to reverberatory furnaces to recover as much copper as possible.